Tell me about the writing of Emperor's New Mind. Did you already have those ideas worked out prior to you starting the book?
Well, I knew why I wanted to write it, but what I didn't know was how the brain could be making use of what I think it needed, you see. And so I learned a bit about neurophysiology, and there is a whole section in the book about neurophysiology, and I thought it a fascinating subject. But I learned about the Hodgkin-Huxley nerve transmission, and I said, there's no hope. You can't preserve coherence that way. Doesn't answer my problems. So when I got to the end of my book, I hoped that I would have an answer to see where in the brain there could be something which could employ the collapse of the wave function. And I didn't. It was left a blank to me. I couldn't see anywhere. So I ended up with something very weak that I didn't believe in, really. Something about crystals or something, I remember, which is in the book, which my excuse for leading it off. But it was not, no, it kind of petered out at the end. Although there was this description of the experiments due to Benjamin Libet, which I thought fascinating. I think they're not legal to do now, because they should be repeated. There were experiments which had to do with the timing of conscious experience.
The readiness potential and free will, telling someone to decide when to make a movement?
I think they're two different things, you see. This was, yes, that may have been part of it. It wasn't so much that, it was the sensory aspect. You see, there was a patient who had an operation on the brain for some other reason, and permission was given for Libet, I guess, to perform experiments on this person, which probably would not be legal. So people tell me, which is a shame because they're fascinating experiments. I do describe them roughly in my book, The Emperor's New Mind, at the end. And the thing is that there's an electrode which touches the finger and the sensation of that. And then there's another electrode in that part of the brain which has to do with the sensation of the finger being touched, sensory part of the brain. And it's all to do with the timing. And there's a clock, which is a fast-moving clock, and the patient has to try and say when he or she feels this. And if you touch the finger, then it's almost instantaneous, apparently. If you touch the part of the brain to do with the sensory, that it takes a little while, in the sense of half a second, not too, quite a long time, before that part gets, maybe it's a quarter of a second. I think it's half a second. Not quite a long time, in a sense. And then there are things about if you touch the finger first and then the brain sensation. Yes, the finger one seems to be instantaneous. The one on the brain takes half a second before it's felt, before the patient registers feeling it, which is curious, already curious. But if you touch the finger and then a quarter of a second later do the brain stimulation, then the brain stimulation is felt, but the finger stimulation is unfelt. How can you unfeel something which you should already have felt?
Uh-huh.
So there's something strange about the temporal, exactly when things are felt and so on, which is quite, and this ties in with other things too. Which,
yes.
Which it seems, for example, if you're playing a sport or something, which I used to play ping pong a lot, not to a huge skill, but I played it.
Uh-huh.
And I think even now the current view is that the conscious, it takes a while for consciousness, maybe half a second. Now, I think that's ridiculous, because if I want to decide whether to hit the ball that way or that way, I see where I think the opponent is and maybe do it that way, you see. That's much less than half a second. then they say, oh, no, it's all unconscious. Said, no, I was deciding to do this.
Right.
He said, no, it can't be. It must be. It's an illusion. You're not really conscious doing it. So that's, I don't know if it's the current view now or not, but it had been. The current view is, no, all these things you think you're doing consciously are really unconscious. I thought, that's ridiculous. I mean, and like if you're piano playing, you say, they might touch a note. I mean, piece may be very, lots and lots and lots of notes going within a half a second. And to decide whether to hit this note maybe slightly more delicately than before, that's a conscious decision. No, it isn't. You can't have time to do that. It must be unconscious. But you see, it's probably the timing of these things is not a straightforward issue. When you think something, I don't know. But you see, if it's to do, I can't make any definite statement. All I think is that there's some monkey business going on.
Okay.
When I say monkey business, it's some subtlety which you can't explain using classical physics.
Somehow I knew you were going to say monkey business.
I see.
It's either that or poppycock. But poppycock. I didn't think that one applied in this case.
Yes, yeah, so it's with monkey business, it tends to me there's something going on there. It's not just random.
Hi, everyone. Hope you're enjoying today's episode. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's CurtJaimungal.org, CurtJaimungal.org.
I just spoke to a neuroscientist named Aaron Sugar, who's reinterpreted the Libet experiments. And he said that we've been making a mistake seeing that there's this potential that comes on approximately half a second to 1 second prior to us deciding to make some action. You can't go from that to infer that, okay, the decision must have been unconscious, therefore we didn't actually decide it. Because he was saying, well, there's a correlation, but the correlation doesn't imply causation. And then in his model, he gives an analogy. He says, if I put on some measuring devices on you that measure your health across the season, they will show a small dip prior to you getting the flu. Does that mean that that small dip caused you to get the flu? Well, some other people get a lower dip as well, but then don't get the flu. So there's this line of reasoning that he goes through and says that he can get this reaction time for consciousness down to actual reaction time, which is 50 milliseconds or so, which is much more in alignment to you consciously deciding to swing the ping pong ball. Rather than what people told you before, which is, no, you think you decided it, but you just unconsciously decided it. And then some post hoc rationalization told you, I decided it. His view is slightly complicated.
Well, I'd be interested to see what it is.
Yeah.
See, my view is it's probably not explicable by classical physics. That there is something, you see, there is something retro causal, nothing to do with this at all. So I usually don't bring this sort of thing into my arguments at all. It's not necessary.
Too speculative?
It's bringing in consciousness, which I'd prefer not to in this issue. You see, I think that's a whole story which I've dabbled in, it's true. Mm-hmm. But it's not something which I could probably seriously contributes to, because it requires understanding too much biology and things like that, which I sometimes say, sorry, I shouldn't be confusing all my stories. Uh-huh. But originally, I was supposed to be a doctor. Both my parents were medical, and they had decided that I was the one who was going to. That was before my sister grew up and actually did become a doctor and married one, so they got two for the price of one. but they were very disappointed when I went and did mathematics instead. But that's all sort of irrelevant to the story, except that it's just as well I didn't do that, because I would never have remembered the different medications that people were supposed to have. I've got them confused because I wouldn't remember the different names. That's all I'm trying to say. Because when it comes to things like biology, it's really not my area. Because it involves different kinds of chemical compounds and what on earth they're doing and which kinds is which and what name is attached to which one. And no, I can't do that kind of thing. So I don't want to. What I'm trying to say is that the consciousness issue, if you're really going to get into what is involved in say, human consciousness, there's a lot of biology involved in that. And there has to be. But that's what we're all, we are biological systems. So it's not going to, it's not my area.
I was speaking to Dr. Michael Levin, who's a biologist, a developmental biologist.
Oh, yeah.
He wanted to know, well, what he's doing is extending platonic space to include biological systems and minds as well. He had a question for you. He wanted to know if you thought platonic space has its own dynamics, or if it's just eternal and static. So that was one question. And then
I can do that one. It's eternal and static. I mean, it's there's no temporal. Time doesn't come into it. It's just mathematics. And mathematical truth isn't a temporal thing. It's true. It doesn't involve time. Nothing to do with it. I mean, you can talk about physics, and of course that involves time.
His second question was, do you think this platonic space includes more than just mathematics?
Well, I'm using the... it depends what you mean by platonic space, I suppose. I'm not sure I understand the question. You see, the Platonism I refer to in the sense of mathematics having its existence independent of us, independent of mathematicians. It's to do mathematics is a bit more like archaeology than you might think. There's the Platonic world out there, and you're digging away at it, and you find some beautiful result, which is sitting there waiting to be discovered, or it doesn't care whether you discover it or not. That's not its concern. So the mathematical world is there. It's not created by us trying to do mathematics. That's the only sense. But when you say giving something else a platonic existence, that's sort of, I don't know quite what that means. Were you trying to, what was the thing?
Okay, let me read the question for the audience as well.
All right.
You've said you're a Platonist about mathematics. Does the mathematical realm exist independently of physical reality? Is the Mandelbrot set out there, even if the universe didn't exist? And do the contents of Platonic space have dynamics of their own? You've answered that already. What's the best way to think about the interaction between Platonic objects, which presumably don't have time, and physical objects, or processes, which operate in time?
Well, I've usually, I have this sort of triangular picture, which I like to draw as an impossible object. And these are what I call the three worlds and the three mysteries. I mean, I used to talk about this. I haven't done it much recently. And the worlds are the Platonic mathematical world and the physical world and the mental world. Yes, and then they see the connections are the three mysteries. So I'm calling them mysteries, you see. One of the mysteries is the physical world and how that depends on mathematics, which seems to be a very close connection. But not every thing in the mathematics. So the way I draw it is only a little bit of the mathematical world seems to be governing. See, there is a sort of view that people have, oh, this is such a beautiful piece of mathematics, it must have relevance to the physical world. Not at all. There's no reason why it should. So there's a lot of very beautiful mathematics going on, which, as far as we can see, has no connection with physics at all. Of course, it might have some distant physical theory that comes about, but I don't see any reason why it should have. This comes up particularly with things when they talk about higher dimensional theories, you see, like in string theory and all that. They like to use these different dimensions of space and so on. I don't see any reason for that at all, just because you've got a mathematical theory which can exist in higher dimensions. No reason why physics should follow it. And then you see, again, there's a next mystery, which is that only part of the physical world seems to have consciousness. So that's a mystery too. And then I say, well, most of conscious activity is not thinking about mathematics. Even if you're a mathematician, you like to have your lunch too, and you like to
have your cappuccino.
Exactly. So it's not just mathematics. And I don't know how much most mathematicians think about mathematics, but certainly it's not all the time with me. A little bit, only a small amount of the time, especially when I get older. I can't, you know, it's harder for me to think about it.
The Economist covers math, physics, philosophy, and AI in a manner that shows how different countries perceive developments and how they impact markets. They recently published a piece on China's new neutrino detector. They cover extending life via mitochondrial transplants, creating an entirely new field of medicine. But it's also not just science. They analyze culture. They analyze finance, economics, business, international affairs across every region. I'm particularly liking their new insider feature. It was just launched this month. It gives you, it gives me, a front row access to The Economist's internal editorial debates, where senior editors argue through the news with world leaders and policymakers in twice weekly long format shows. Basically, an extremely high quality podcast. Whether it's scientific innovation or shifting global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage beyond headlines. As a Toll listener, you get a special discount. Head over to economist.com/TOE to subscribe. That's economist.com/TOE for your discount.